Hello, I'm Rudranath Sanyal. Welcome to War and Peace, your go-to program on security matters and geopolitics. Once again, we thank all our viewers who have kept in touch with us all these years. In our previous episode, we ended on a note of surprise and hope. Since then, the world has indeed experienced a few surprises and seen some measures of hope unfolding. We saw the picturesque progress of the Amarnath Yatra and much more in the realm of security matters. In this edition of War and Peace, we will take a look at some of the benign security measures in Jammu and Kashmir after the clause of Article 370 of the Indian Constitution was changed to bring Jammu and Kashmir on par with other states and union territories. So, our lead topic for you in this edition of War and Peace is drills for peace. We will also bring you a capsule on the significance of the Office of the Chief of Defence Staff in India. And in our file shot segment, we will have for you a vignette from Sarvarpur, a remote village in Punjab that is an epitome of communal harmony. Our guests today are Captain Shekhar Dutt, former Deputy National Security Advisor and Governor, who has joined us from Surajkund, and Dr. Y.S. Rajan, eminent scientist who co-authored several books with Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam on the potentials of India. He has joined us from Bengaluru. So, now our lead topic for you in this edition of War and Peace, drills for peace. Year after year, this is a typical night scene at the base camp in Baltal on the way to the holy Amarnath cave in Jammu and Kashmir. All the joy and excitement in what is otherwise a rough mountain terrain is an unforgettable experience made possible by round-the-clock vigil by the security forces. It is facilitated by the Shrine Board and the local people. The drill is unobtrusive but strict. Army, paramilitary and the police team up and keep terrorists at bay round the clock. Mountain rescue teams are also at work. Since anti-national elements try to mingle with the crowd, all vehicles are electronically identified, tagged and traced right from the entry points to the valley. Roads are sanitized by road opening parties. When helicopters carrying pilgrims whiz past, a seamless ground support system is at work day and night, though it is often invisible. These tried and tested security drills, with an admixture of old and new techniques, have proved to be effective not only along the route to the Amarnath cave, but all across the Kashmir Valley. Cross-border operatives are increasingly falling into the nets of security forces. Peace-loving locals on their part provide inputs to the government agencies whenever they notice anything suspicious. We saw in the report how such measures secure not only the rough tracks towards the holy Amarnath cave, but also several other neighborhoods in the Kashmir Valley. Now let's take the first question to Captain Shekhar Dutt, who has joined us from Surajkund. Captain Dutt, you are a veteran army officer who took part in the 1971 war, and later as an IS officer, you have also been a defense secretary. And then you were a deputy national security advisor too. What do you make of the security drills that are in place in Jammu and Kashmir now? Do you think some of the other advanced nation states could do any better than this to keep terrorists at bay?
I am absolutely sure that Indian government and the Indian armed forces, the way they are in J&K and having direct communication with the people, nobody could have done any better. Israel or United States have been in situations in the Middle East or in within their own country, and it is not just a couple of weeks disturbance, it is goes on for years. Kashmir is much more quieter and amenable than anywhere else, and the Indian forces and the government are dealing the situation in the best way that anybody could do. Technology has definitely been of good assistance to the Indian forces, but it is much more than that. The Indian forces have enormous goodwill in that area, and for that matter, rest of the country. In fact, you might recall that some of the reports elicited from people and other media sources have been that the most respected organization is the Indian Armed Forces.
Captain Dutt, you have worked closely with Dr. Kalam, and in your own book on national security, you have spoken about the need to get accustomed to the process of change and shift from a box-based system to transformational mode. Can you qualify this?
Yeah, sure. The transformation is a necessity in life. And Kashmir has been under transformation. Kashmiri people, remember, have been continuously participating in the elections, and they've been choosing their own representatives. They have their own teams who are playing in games, and so it's a participation of the Kashmiri people. You go to any industry melas, and you will find that the local Kashmiri artisans, they have some of the best stalls.
Now let's go over to Dr. Y.S. Rajan, who has joined us from Bengaluru. Dr. Rajan, we saw in our report how tried and tested drills and technologies are yielding effective results in Jammu and Kashmir. Do you think any other advanced country could do any better?
I think for security management in those areas of sensitive border, I think we started equipping one around the time of the Kargil war. I think we were not having enough of surveillance systems, etc. Over a period it has been built, and then I think probably recently they have stepped it up to a point where they are able to see there are a variety of things to be seen. You have to intercept. It is not only seeing the enemy tracks, which can be done by radar, IR devices, etc., but also have to know many of them through the radio emissions. The mobiles and all satellite phones and all the enemy would be using, those things should be tracked. These are called ELINT, electronic intelligence. So in all this, I think we are getting better and better equipped. So that's the reason they are able to do it. I am sure they would have considered all these things before taking steps.
What do you make of the natural assets of Jammu and Kashmir that can be used to propagate peace and development?
Because it is clean and good, there are many clean technologies, electronics, software development, etc., can come, because very easy. Because I remember even once when Kalamji was the president of India, he had gone to Kashmir, and I had also accompanied him, and they have talked quite a few things. And example, people talk about Davos in Switzerland. It is an ice-clad place. Like this, there are so many things which can be developed around Jammu, Kashmir, and Ladakh. Then, of course, the natural one are some of those gifted ones like saffron, and there are special herbs which are available. These can be done in a way, a little bit of extra making. and there are also other items where money, wealth can be created. Lot of people can be employed in high-end job.
And Captain Shekhar Dutt, you have, as the Defence Secretary, studied the features of Jammu and Kashmir, and you are also familiar with regions like Chhattisgarh, where you were a governor. What is it that is special about Jammu and Kashmir in terms of natural resources?
Yeah, absolutely correct. Dr. Kalam was very keen on India becoming a hub for electronics manufacture. And for electronics, you would understand, it requires a very clean atmosphere. Kashmir, Ladakh, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Northeast are such areas, and we can definitely see the light coming from that side, that we shall have another industrial revolution of the higher end of technology fabrication in those hills, including Kashmir.
What is the best way to address the minds of subversive elements who have been brainwashed by cross-border forces over the years? After all, many of the terrorists are also individuals who have been brainwashed by operatives.
Yeah, this brainwashing also has been done with the same tool outside. And this has been the major tool of the Pakistani army. You recall, Pakistani army could not fathom the life after the Bangladesh war of 1971, when they were so soundly defeated by India that it became a lesson to every war historian. Pakistan army has been smarting ever since, knowing that they cannot do anything to India on conventional warfare. They have gone into these low intensity warfare, and this is a tool they have been subverting through communication and through their discourses, which happens both in Pakistan or outside, and their target has been the Kashmiri youth.
Captain Shekhar Dutt, coming to the global canvas now, India's credibility is high both in South Asia, like we saw in Bhutan, and also among powerful nation states. Do you think because of its credibility, India is able to build enduring partnerships cutting across geopolitical divides?
India's credibility has been there, and the Kashmiris have been always finding it far more reliable to listen to the Indian story rather than to the Pakistani one. Only thing is that there are certain leaders who are washing their linen, dirty linen, outside, and they have access to grind. And these leaders, the communication requires to be obstructed, if not broken. But more and more new young leaders or people with more credibility will emerge, and this will happen in a continuous manner, so that the Kashmiri youth can be brought into complete mainstream.
Dr. Rajan, what do you make of India's credibility, especially of the country's scientific community that is responsible for giant strides in the areas ranging from space to nuclear energy?
It is growing. It is doing well. There is a human resource, even though bulk of it has not been tapped, but still those human resources itself is an attraction. Why? They not only contribute, they also buy. So therefore, worldwide, there is an interest in India as a market, as a place to join partnership and then do things like this. There are variety of it. That forms the basic credibility. Then another thing is, by and large, all the items in which all the relationship with India had, with ups and downs also, India doesn't betray a persons who help them. Even when somebody doesn't help them, they don't go and create trouble for others.
You're watching War and Peace, the country's longest running program on security matters and geopolitics. Our guests today are Dr. Y.S. Rajan, eminent defense and space scientist, who has co-authored several books with Dr. Kalam. He has joined us from Bengaluru. And Captain Shekhar Dutt, a war veteran who was also Defense Secretary, Deputy National Security Advisor, and Governor. We will take a break now, after which we will bring you a capsule on the significance of the Office of the Chief of Defense Staff and much more. Please keep watching.
Informative, incisive, intensive. Get your daily dose of news and analysis in English News Night every weekday at 9 p.m. on DD India. Channel number 620 on Tata Sky, 199 on Dish TV, 150 on Airtel, 28 on UCN, and 395 on Videocon D2H.
Welcome back. You're watching War and Peace, your go-to program on security matters and geopolitics. Well, you have heard Prime Minister Narendra Modi's recent decision to appoint a Chief of Defense Staff. This is for still better integration of the Army, Navy and Air Force. So let's now take a look at a capsule on the significance of the Office of the Chief of Defense Staff. Military personnel deployed in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands are under a tri-service integrated command headed by either a Lieutenant General or officers of the equivalent ranks of Vice Admiral and Air Marshal in the Navy and Air Force, respectively. Under this unified command, the joint action of Army, Navy and Air Force proved extraordinarily effective in the aftermath of the earthquake and tsunami in 2004. Since the Kargil War, there has been a demand for such an integrated operation and chain of command at the highest level for the armed forces. The Prime Minister's decision to create the position of a Chief of Defence Staff or CDS is a step in that direction, as a result of which all the armed forces personnel, including the three service chiefs, will come under the command of a Chief of Defence Staff. Unlike the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff Committee, the CDS will have a regular tenure for more efficient utilization of both military personnel and hardware, and with reduced costs. With a fixed tenure and a chain of command under him, the Chief of Defence Staff will also be in a position to work out long-term strategies and policies in all situations and all weather conditions. Let's now straight away go over to Captain Shekhar Dutt in Surajkund. Captain Dutt, as the Defence Secretary and then as the Deputy National Security Advisor, you have seen how the demand for a Chief of Defence Staff grew after the Kargil War. What details would you like to share with us?
The Chairman Chief of the Joint Staff kind of arrangement, but it's a permanent arrangement. Chairman Chief of Joint Staff is a person who's the senior-most chief and is only there till the duration of his service. The CDS would have a time, say 2 years or some time given, so he will have very easy access to all three services because he would have be in the direct chain of command.
What is it that the Chief of Defence Staff can do that could be beyond the scope of the existing Chiefs of Staff Committee and its chairman?
Because he is not in the direct chain of command. The chairman, the Chief of Staff is not the same as the Chief of the Defence Staff. Chief of the Defence Staff is in the direct chain of command. All the chiefs will report to him. All military operations will be controlled by him or directed by him.
So the CDS with an assured term can work on a roadmap and a time-bound plan.
Very long-term planning can be done, that today we are in this this thing tomorrow, and our geopolitical situation requires India to have these capability, the CDS would have a very, very important role, because it will be these three services in a joint manner to go ahead and transform themselves according to the geopolitical and technological innovation.
Well, viewers, all the military preparedness is essentially a deterrence that helps propagate peace. And as you know, segments of the civil society also play a key role in maintaining both external and internal tranquility. Now, from our file shot segment, let us look at a vignette on the remote village of Sarwarpur that has become an epitome of communal harmony. On the way to Ludhiana from Chandigarh, in the middle of the vast expanse of rural land, is situated this quiet village called Sarwarpur. If you come here in your formal gear, you might feel out of place in this little rural center where only bicycles are suitable for negotiating village roads. But when you soak in the ambience, you at once feel at home. Children and adults offer you a warm welcome in unison. Together, they are a group of messengers of peace and communal harmony. Sikhs, Muslims and Hindus make up this group. And the high point of their message came in the form of a freshly built and painted mosque at a site next to the village Gurdwara. A group of Sikh gentlemen organized resources to ready the mosque and hand it over to the Muslims in the village. The Shiromani Gurdwara Prabhandak Committee was involved in the process.
We are two brothers, one living in England, I am living here. We decided to build a mosque here. As we concerned man Tufail Muhammad, we contact them and talk about the mosque. At last they said you can do anything, and we made this mosque. As we can do.
हाँ, बाकी ये जो गांव है हमारा, इन लोगों ने हमारा हर तरह से सहयोग दिया है, आज तक देते हैं, पहले से भी, क्योंकि हम लोकल हैं, कहीं गए नहीं।
From what we can see, the Sarwarpur village has all the potential of becoming a little hub from where both rural and urban centers can draw inspiration and spread the message of peace and communal harmony. Dr. Y.S. Rajan, in the vignette, we saw an example of how common people walk the extra mile to propagate peace.
I think it is a part of the great Indian tradition and part of the great tradition the gurus gave. So the 10 gurus have been a great blessing for not just for Punjab, but for the India and the whole world. They were all in the part of a great tradition where we respect everybody. We respect everybody. We respect every aspects of somebody's culture, somebody's way of living, and then we live together. And then, of course, when something is disturbed on that, I think we have to be ready to knock it out so that the disturbance doesn't create a problem for others also.
Captain Shekhar Dutt, in the story from Sarwarpur, we saw that religion and ethnicity can actually help nation building.
Yeah. Because it is the religion or custom or tradition which has enabled the people to move forward. And you'll find that Kashmir especially, with the enormous amount of impression of the Sufism and how hugely they are more akin to liberal thoughts, and in fact many of the liberal thoughts have come out of Kashmir into the greater India.
And Dr. Y.S. Rajan in Bangalore, in our recent edition of War and Peace, we started the point about a lasting solution to end all strife and usher in peace. What, according to you, is a lasting solution?
Lasting solution, see, to expect a world without any strife, without any problem, because out of some 1 million, some 10 fellows can go wrong. but that is a problem of statistics. So there I heard say the Bhagavad Gita, yatra yogeshwara krishno, we need that thing, the knowledge, the concentration and everything. Yatra partho dhanurdharah, we have to have a partha dhanurdharah, you have to be armed and then be ready. Without that, this is the double bond. On one side you have to have the economics, knowledge and other thing, on other side the protection, ready protection. It is this balance which will keep us steady, not only for us, you can also help many people. If we are very steady and not having any strife and problems, it will be. But that strife is not going to be a very nice mithai jaisa nahi hota hai.
And how do you look at the future?
Future is good. I think the young people, actually the independent speech, PM said about the aspirational India, Akansh. I think that one has gone up. And then people are also willing to work for it instead of saying, come on, you give. They want to work and do it. So that part of outlook has come, that is the great strength for India. And India's future is quite good. India means, when I mean is Indians who are now there, present, to be born, and who may be born much later, all of them, they are going to have a great thing.
Captain Shekhar Dutt, how do you look at the future?
India will develop, and along with it, Kashmir shall. And the chances of getting it even better, that means if India develops at a certain pace, Kashmir can develop at a larger or a faster pace.
And so many other states.
Yeah, and so many other states, because they have the opportunity. They have the natural resources. And those natural resources of Kashmir are hugely advantageous to them. So I'm absolutely sure that once this normalcy, complete normalcy, comes in, and this will come gradually and as time goes by in a faster space, and you will find that the mainstreaming of development will happen very fast.
So, on that developing note, we come to the end of this edition of War and Peace. If you wish to write to us, you can send your letters to War and Peace, Room 513, Tower B, Doordarshan Bhavan, Copernicus Marg, New Delhi 110001. You can also send an email to warandpeace2004@hotmail.com. Keep looking out for more insightful editions of War and Peace, both on DD News and DD India. So, thank you, Dr. Y.S. Rajan in Bangalore.
Thank you.
Thank you, Captain Shekhar Dutt in Surajkund.
Thank you.
And thank you all. Bye-bye.